Hi, it's Neil here, and we're looking at week two in the Horngren chapter, Horngren textbook of cost management candidates, chapter 13. And the name of that chapter is about pricing decisions. And in this week, we actually do more than pricing. We actually get down to the bones of how do you actually manage a particular long-term price that you're locked in on. And so what we did cover was short run and long run pricing decisions. What was the actual difference between short run and long run? In the short run, there was a narrow band of relevant costs. In the long run, however, the relevant costs that were pertinent to the price that you're setting were much broader because more fixed costs become relevant in the long term. Just about all of the costs, if we want to sustain the business in the organization, about all of the costs are relevant. And so when it comes to a long-term pricing decision, you're caught between a rock and a hard place. And the reason is that because there's more costs that are relevant, then you have to take greater action, because if you cannot cover all these relevant costs, which is much more, then you won't be able to sustain your business in the long run. And that's a big challenge. You need to take specific action, not just setting the price. And that's why we look at target costing in this session. So short run, long run pricing decisions. The impact of long run pricing decisions is to make broader the scope of relevant costs that need to be considered. Next, we looked at the factors that are impacting on decisions. The CCC, you know the CCC. I'm not talking about car, credit card, and condo. No, I'm talking about competition. I'm talking about customers. I'm talking about costs. And often, you may not have control over the customer. The customers are demanding. Electronics industry, their pressure on suppliers in China, it's costing them 5% every 3 months. And that's a norm in the industry, and the pressure from international customers is so great. So you may not be able to do much with the customer. What about competitors? Well, there's competition everywhere. There's not much you can do about competitors. Yes, you can copy them. Yes, you can try and mimic them. Yes, you can try and find out what's their secret. You can do all that, but that will not make you a leader. That will make you a follower. So is there some way that you can get out in front and beat their competition and actually have a long-term sustainable relationship with your big customers? And that's where we need to focus on costs. Strategic cost management is about identifying costs and finding ways where we can cut costs over time. Is there a big technique out there that we can use, employ, that can help solve this problem? Because we're under pressure from customers, from competitors. The only thing we really have control over is our operations and the resources that these operations are consuming. So is there a technique out there? Yes, there is. It is target costing. We know the Japanese are very good at this, and many other companies are starting to do this worldwide, but really there were 5 steps in target costing. I want to draw your attention to probably the first step and the fifth step, which are probably the most important parts. The first step is where you actually target your product. Are you a high-end SLR camera manufacturer? So you're targeted up into the $20,000 to $30,000 Hong Kong dollar range. We're talking about $5,000, $6,000, $7,000 US dollar range. Or are you just a little compact camera where you're targeting a lower level of functionality, a narrow range of functionality at a $2,000 Hong Kong dollar range, you know, $300 or $400 US dollar range? You see, where you target your product kind of dictates what functions customers are expecting for that price point. And so that's what we mean by functional analysis. The first part is target cost. Of course, from that, you can get the target price. Then you may want to make a 10% margin or a 20% or a 30%, and so that will give you your target cost. Then you can do cost analysis, where you actually break out what are all the different cost elements. Or basically, in other words, what are all the different resources that we are consuming in order to make that product that we have put into a certain functional price point? Then, right at the end, and this is the magic. Let me say this again. This is the magic that a lot of firms neglect, a lot of firms do not know how to implement, and that is value engineering. You can do 1, 2, 3, 4, and if you miss out on step 5, you are doomed. you will not be sustainable no matter what. The customers will eat you alive. The competitors will eat you alive. You will not be around in the long term. So what is this value engineering? What is the secret sauce here that can make you a survivor in the long term? And that's what you want, isn't it? Value engineering is about a few things. It is about design analysis, and it's about process value analysis. So what do we mean about these two things that every company can think about? Design analysis is thinking about, is there some way that we can make simpler, changing components, reducing the components, making, having more modular systems in the product that doesn't change its functionality, but the design uses less resources, so therefore you can use less cost to make the same product for the same functionality. For example, you may actually change some components in the circuit board. You may actually leave out some capacitors under where the USB plugs into. They should be there, but they're not there. It will still work, but that 1% of the time it may blow up, okay? We know that some suppliers do that in the electronics industry, but we're talking about good design. So we're talking about modularity. The US car manufacturers were very good at this, at making the whole dashboards modular, and so they're assembled somewhere else, and then they come in, they just plug in to the whole car frame, and there's your dashboard. Whereas 20, 30 years ago, the dashboard was made bit by bit within the car. This modularity of different systems, and then they sort of connected together like Lego blocks, that's what we mean by design. Finally, process value analysis. You need to get this. And this is where we actually looking at activities. We're trying to map the activities in the organization. We're trying to map them into a value chain. What happens first, second, third, fourth, fifth? And we're trying to think, okay, some of these activities here, this activity is value added, this one is not. This one is value added, this one's value added, this one is not. So therefore we try and eliminate that activity, and so therefore the total resources consumed by the activities in making the product are less. So there we have our activity map. And so through cutting down the non-value added activities, we are able to reduce our costs. So in the end, what we're trying to do is actually reduce our costs. We're trying to, through changing the design, by eliminating non-value added activities. In total, this is the secret sauce. This is the secret sauce of value engineering that is not covered often when we talk about target costing. And this will enable you to actually compete with your competitors and your customers. So there you go. Catch you in the next session. Thank you very much.